What's going good, people? Welcome everyone to episode 23 of From the Vault. Don't forget to like and comment this episode, share this episode on social media, like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. All the links are in the description box and comment section, and check out all the past episodes in the archive. Thanks to everyone who have already done that. Now, sorry this episode is a week late. Shit came up last week that prevented me to do this then, but it's up now, so the schedule is going to be backed up a week. Speaking of the schedule, so we got the week of August 5th, episode 24 on the Hollywood Blondes, so send in those Hollywood Blonde questions in the comment section below. The week of August 12th, episode 25 on Vader 1993. The week of August 19th, episode 26 on SummerSlam 1994. And the week of August 26th, episode 27. And the winner of the episode 27 poll was Razor Ramon 1992 through 96. And then the week of September 2nd, episode 28, I decided that I'm going to be doing that topic on what finished second in the episode 27 poll, and for episode 28, it's going to be Rick Rude 1991 through 94. As always, week subject to change based on if shit comes up. As for this current episode, episode 23... In 1993, Shawn Michaels watched an episode of WCW. He saw a guy and said, "He'd be perfect to be my bodyguard." And the rest is history. Triple Crown winner, longest reigning WWF champion of the 90s. But as successful as he was, imagine if they tapped into his full potential. This is From the Vault, Diesel, 1993 through 96. Kevin Nash's road to the World Wrestling Federation was, well, his road was a pothole-filled one, to say the very least. How ironic, him coming from Michigan, and Michigan's probably the worst state in terms of potholes, but I digress. Nash's road was not a good one, to say the very least. I mean, if you thought that this guy with the shit I'm gonna be talking about here first... This guy was going to be one of the most memorable names of the last 25 years. You're fucking nuts. Nash, he had to deal with a ton of shit before coming to the WWF. He made his wrestling debut on September 5th, 1990 for WCW at Clash of the Champions 12 as Steel of the tag team The Master Blasters. In early 1991, he was rebranded as simply The Master Blaster before being repackaged in June of that year as Oz. That lasted for a little bit until January 1992 when he was repackaged once again as Vinnie Vegas, originally part of Harley Race's A Half Ton of Holy Hell stable, then part of Diamond Dallas Page's Diamond Mine stable, where he would team with Scotty Flamingo, the future Raven, he would team with the Diamond Stud, future Click brother Scott Hall, eventually teaming with Diamond Dallas Page himself, and DDP in Vegas was known as the Vegas Connection. But by 1993, all those teams had ended, all those guys were elsewhere, and Kevin Nash, he was really going nowhere in WCW. He wasn't, you know, he wasn't a J-Brone, but he wasn't really much of anything else. He was just in the fucking middle, which, you have a 7-footer and don't know what the fuck to do with him? Now that's early 90s WCW for you. Thank God for Kevin Nash, Shawn Michaels was watching WCW one week. Shawn Michaels, who was in the WWF, he was in the Intercontinental Championship hunt. You know, he was former IC champion, eventually future IC champion. But Shawn saw Vinnie Vegas one week and thought, you know what? That guy would be perfect for me as a bodyguard. Shawn Michaels talked to the Steiner brothers, who knew Nash way before Nash was even in professional wrestling. Nash once told the story of, "Thank God I was buddies with the Steiners before I was even in the business." But Steiners and the Nash were buddies. Steiners became the middlemen between Kevin Nash and Vince McMahon. Therefore, there was no allegations of tampering. Kevin Nash eventually got his release from WCW. He was like, you know what, I'm done with the business. I'm going to go back to being a bouncer. I'm just, this wrestling thing ain't for me. But you know, he had other plans with that one, of course. But Nash got his release from WCW, and as one final fuck you to them, he faxed his resignation from WCW to Vince McMahon from the WCW headquarters. So Nash is no longer under WCW contract. He had his meeting with Vince McMahon, got the bodyguard pitch. He's going to be the bodyguard of Shawn Michaels. Shane McMahon gave him the gimmick and the name of Diesel. Nash was from Detroit, the Motor City, big 7-foot badass. What else do you need to know there? So Nash made his debut for the WWF on June 6th, 1993, at a house show in Albany, New York. That is where Nash was introduced to Shawn Michaels, and the rest is history. It was on that night at the Albany, New York house show where Shawn Michaels regained the Intercontinental Championship from Marty Jannetty. And at first, Shawn's bodyguard didn't have a name. He was just the insurance policy. However, at King of the Ring 1993, 1 week after his debut, we were given the name of Shawn Michaels' bodyguard. His name was Diesel. Now, from June through September, Diesel would remain in Shawn's corner, helping Shawn win, helping Shawn regain the Intercontinental Championship, all of that. He even had his first match with the WWF on August 13th at Madison Square Garden. It was Diesel, Shawn Michaels, and Bam Bam Bigelow versus Mr. Perfect, Marty Jannetty, and Tatanka in a six-man tag match. Diesel would pin Perfect to win the match. And Diesel and Shawn would team up on house shows. That was until Shawn Michaels' suspension in September. I will get into that topic if I ever talk about Shawn Michaels in 1993. Now, at that point, he's off of TV, he's suspended, Diesel's on his own, you know, just put him in the ring against a bunch of J-Brones, and that's exactly what happened. Diesel would rack up win against Jabroni, 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 Jabroni. He would just win. And Diesel, he would make his in-ring pay-per-view debut at Survivor Series 1993. Here, Diesel was a part of IRS's team against Razor Ramon's team. Diesel would be the first man eliminated after an elbow drop from Randy Savage. Survivor Series 1993 was also Shawn Michaels' return from suspension. After Survivor Series, the duo of Shawn and Diesel was going to be back together. Let's skip to January 1994, the Royal Rumble to be exact. It was at the Royal Rumble in 1994 where Diesel got his second huge break in less than a year. The first was being brought into the WWF and being paired with Shawn Michaels. The second big break for Diesel was being put in the Royal Rumble match itself and eliminating a ton of people. Now, when it comes to pro wrestling and when it comes to wrestling crowds, sometimes you never know how a crowd is going to react to someone. Diesel comes in at number 7, and he proceeds to be a one-man army. He eliminates one after another. In no time at all, it's 7 eliminations, and it's 7 eliminations in a row. Now, that thing I was talking about, crowd reaction? Keep this in mind. Diesel was a heel. He was associated with one of the top heels in the company. And just the match prior, Diesel was a part of the 10-on-1 murder of The Undertaker. You fast forward one match, Diesel eliminates 7 men in a row. Diesel was getting babyface reactions. And there were some Diesel chants in there. And it was at this moment, hearing the crowd react to this guy, this big guy, and keep this in mind, this was at a time where, you know, the steroid stuff was being cut out and all that, but you know what? Take steroids out of the matter, dude's still 7 feet tall, so it was at this moment, Diesel's eliminating people, the crowd's reacting to him, Vince goes, "Goddamn, pal, this guy? He's more than just a bodyguard, hell, this guy can be my world champion one day." And with this run, now known as the Diesel Spot, Kevin Nash's push as a wrestler in the WWF began. We fast forward to April, where Diesel gets his first proper feud in the company. It's a continuation of the Shawn Michaels Razor Ramon feud, just you swap Shawn Michaels for Diesel, because post-WrestleMania 10, Shawn was taking a bit of time off as a wrestler. Diesel, he became more of the wrestler, while Shawn became more of a manager. So instead of Shawn wrestler, Diesel bodyguard, it was Diesel wrestler, Shawn manager. On April 13th, 1994, it was a taping for WWF Superstars that eventually aired on April 30th. Diesel won his first championship, the Intercontinental Championship, when he defeated Razor Ramon with Shawn's help. New Intercontinental Champion, back at a time when the Intercontinental Championship actually meant something really big, and this was coming off the heels of that great WrestleMania 10 ladder match, so the Intercontinental Championship was a big fucking deal here. Now, the Diesel Razor feud, it was still going on, but it was put on the back burner just a little bit on television. Because we fast forward to June, Diesel is in a one-match program with Bret Hart for King of the Ring. It was Intercontinental Champion Diesel taking on World Champion Bret Hart, champion versus champion for Bret's World Wrestling Federation Championship. Diesel's IC title was not on the line. They had an almost 23-minute match that was fucking amazing. For someone who was in the company only a year, hadn't had that many matches in the company to begin with, had less than 4 years pro wrestling experience. I mean, Kevin Nash, Diesel, this wasn't just another giant who got a fluke reaction one night. It's not that, oh, he's big, we must push him. No, this wasn't just another giant. This was one of those matches where, yeah, goddamn, pal, he gets a reaction, he can go with Bret, fuck it, he's my next champion. You know, being paired with Shawn Michaels, getting the Royal Rumble spot, this world title match against Bret was Diesel's third big break in the company, and it was really the break where, even though Vince wasn't there that night, it was, if I'm not mistaken, the only pay-per-view Vince ever missed was King of the Ring 1994. Vince saw this and it's like, yeah, Diesel's my next champion. We fast forward to the day of SummerSlam 1994, August 29th. That morning, you had the Regis and Kathy Lee show. Shawn Michaels and Diesel was on that show advertising SummerSlam that night. And on that night, it was going to be Diesel versus Razor Ramon for Diesel's Intercontinental Championship. But not only were they advertising the match, we also find out that morning, Diesel and Shawn Michaels are now the new World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions. The night prior at a house show in Indianapolis, Shawn and Diesel defeated the Head Shrinkers to win the titles. We fast forward to SummerSlam that night. You had Diesel with Shawn Michaels in his corner versus Razor Ramon with Chicago Bears legend and Pro Football Hall of Famer Walter Payton in his corner. They were in Chicago. Walter Payton is a Chicago sports legend, and Walter Payton was the X factor to prevent Shawn Michaels from interfering like he did when Diesel first won the match, first won the title. Match goes about 15 minutes. It was a very good match between the two. I mean, people want to say, oh, Diesel only had good matches with Shawn and Bret. Fuck that. He had a good, really good match. A couple of good matches with Razor Ramon that year. But we get to the end of the match. Diesel sets Razor up for Shawn to deliver sweet chin music. Razor ducks and Shawn hits Diesel with the super kick. Razor Ramon pins Diesel 1-2-3. Razor Ramon regains the Intercontinental Championship from Diesel, and this is where Diesel's next program begins. Now, even though Diesel and Shawn Michaels were the tag team champions, there were problems starting to begin between the two, and I mentioned the accidental sweet chin music at SummerSlam in the Diesel-Razor Intercontinental Championship match. Then we get a second one. October 30th, Action Zone, Diesel Shawn Michaels versus Razor Ramon and the 1-2-3 Kid in a tag team championship match. And by the way, this match was amazing. One of the best tag title matches and one of the more underrated tag team championship matches in company history. Diesel sets Razor up for Shawn to deliver Sweet Chin Music, and just like SummerSlam, Shawn misses, hits Diesel. This time it didn't lead to defeat. Diesel and Shawn retained the belts, but still, a second Sweet Chin Music. We get to Survivor Series. Diesel and Shawn Michaels lead the Teamsters against Razor Ramon and 123 Kid's bad guys. Diesel is a one-man wrecking crew. It's like the Royal Rumble. Diesel is eliminating everybody. He eliminated Fatu. He eliminated the Kid. He eliminated Sione. All within a minute of each other. All with the jackknife powerbomb, and hell, he jackknifed Davey Boy Smith that led to Davey's elimination. Granted, it was by countout, but still, jackknifed Davey as well. And then we get to the end of the match. Shawn had yet to get in. Diesel had pretty much wrestled all... I wouldn't say he wrestled the entire match, but he wrestled a ton of it. Shawn wants to get in to hit the Sweet Chin Music so that he can get the elimination and all that stuff. So Diesel once again sets Razor up for Shawn to deliver the Sweet Chin Music. And just like at SummerSlam and just like on Action Zone, Shawn Michaels hits Diesel by mistake again. And as Gorilla Monsoon said, the honeymoon is over. First time... shit happens. Second time, third time, fuck you. Shawn, he acts all big and bad and then running away from Diesel because Diesel wants to fucking kill Shawn. Their other team members try to get them back because at this point, it's 5-on-1. You know, get back to the ring, we're gonna lose. Razor Ramon ends up winning the match after all five members of the Teamsters get counted out at once. Post-match, Shawn Michaels, he's leaving the building. He says he doesn't need Diesel. He made Diesel. Without him, there is no Diesel. He threw down his half of the tag team championships, ending the team with him and Diesel, and thus the tag team championships are now vacant. The Shawn Diesel feud had begun, but really it was being put on the back burner for a brief period of time with mentions here and there. Now, Diesel is no longer the tag team champions, but now he's a babyface. Bret Hart, he had to be replaced in his rematch against Mr. Bob Backlund for the Madison Square Garden house show 3 nights after Survivor Series. And on that MSG house show, Diesel replaced Bret. Diesel hit Backlund with the jackknife powerbomb, and in 8 seconds, Diesel's your new World Wrestling Federation champion. Now, say what you will about how fast he was pushed to the top, but you can't say he didn't deliver on his way there. He delivered everywhere possible. As Shawn Michaels' bodyguard? Check. Royal Rumble performance? Check. Intercontinental champion? Check. World title match against Bret Hart at King of the Ring? Check. Tag team champions? Check. Survivor Series performance? Check. In almost 18 months, Kevin Nash went from almost out of the business. You keep that in mind. He really wanted to be done with pro wrestling in 1993, and thank God Shawn Michaels watched WCW and wanted him to come in as his bodyguard. But in almost 18 months, Kevin Nash went from almost out of the business to being World Wrestling Federation champion. Now, nowadays, people would destroy something like this. Back then, at least at first, people loved this. Diesel throughout 1994, he was getting over as a babyface despite the fact that he was a heel. Now we get to the thing that people most talk about when talking about Kevin Nash's first run in the WWF. And I'm referring to Diesel's WWF Championship reign. The almost year-long reign, the longest reign of the decade, and the reign that people say is the reason why WWF in 1995 was so terrible. people put all the blame on Diesel. They put the blame on no one else. It's Diesel's fault, that long reign. He's the reason the WWF was so terrible. Diesel this, Diesel that. Which, no, it fucking wasn't. I mean, first of all, shit doesn't help that they neuter Diesel. I mean, they fucking turned him from a cool badass to a pandering doofus. I mean, what got Diesel over in the first place? Being a badass. And what happened when they put the title on him? They turned him into every fed babyface from years gone by. They didn't have a fucking clue what to do with him as a babyface world champion. I mean, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. He was a badass when he got over. He should have been a badass as a champion. But nope, we're going to turn him into a pandering, hey, I'm the champion and, you know, I respect you and I this and I don't need your money. I care for the fans. That wasn't going to fucking work. Diesel got over as a badass. He should have remained as a badass. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Keep it simple, stupid. But they changed what Diesel was, and now his first round of house shows. I mean, a champion is, he's only as good as the challengers you have lined up for him. So what about Diesel's first round of house shows as WWF champion? Oh, I know. Let's have him do competitive matches against a man who he beat in 8 seconds, and we showed the footage on national television. Yeah, but we're going to sell the fact that Diesel Backlund's going to be competitive. And you hear Nash talk about this, it was fucking terrible. Then they put Diesel against Jeff Jarrett, which, no offense to Jarrett, Jarrett hadn't even won the Intercontinental Championship yet, so how can he be a viable world title contender if he hadn't even beat Razor yet for the IC title? And then they put Diesel with King Kong Bundy, which by 1995, King Kong Bundy was no longer money, especially in a world title program. But then, out of his first round of house shows, we get his first huge program as the WWF champion, even though it was only one pay-per-view, but Diesel Bret Hart for Royal Rumble 1995. Bret was the former champion, Bret was screwed out of the title, and Bret was owed his rematch. Now, on paper, this wasn't a bad idea. Bret and Diesel were great at King of the Ring 7 months earlier, and the match here at the Royal Rumble was a great match. However, the problem lies in the fact that unlike King of the Ring, Bret Diesel here at the Rumble was a babyface match. So you're making the fans have to choose who they're going to cheer for, Bret Hart or Diesel, which can cause a split crowd, which is not what you want to do with the man who you want to be the leader of your new generation. Because you had the people who loved Diesel. It's not like they were booing him or anything. You had that group of people that loved Diesel. You also had that group of people who loved Bret. But your new babyface champion, the leader of the new generation, what do you do his first major match as the champion? You don't put him over. Of fucking course. Because fuck you, that's why. Diesel's your guy now. His first big match with him as champion, you do a no contest because you don't want to hurt either of the two, which ended up hurting both of them in the long run. I mean, that's like pulling your ace pitcher after 30 pitches into a perfect game. No injury, nothing's wrong. You pull him because fuck you. Yeah, it was stupid. Again, the match was great, but all the other shit was terrible. But after Bret, you got the eventual match with Shawn Michaels. You had the backstory of them as a unit, the three super kicks that caused the team to dissolve. The tag titles had to be vacated. Diesel wins the world title. Shawn wins the Royal Rumble. Shawn's the number one contender for WrestleMania 11. A few problems with this one. Number one, Shawn beat a bunch of J-Brones in that Rumble match. I mean, outside of Bulldog, Luger, Owen, I mean, hell, Owen was only in that match for 3 seconds, so it's... if you're only in it for 3 seconds, were you really in it? But outside of a couple names, name me someone who was credible in that match. It was Shawn and a bunch of J-Brones, minus a couple of other people. Number two, this wasn't the main focus of that WrestleMania. I mean, Diesel, again, he's your guy, the leader of the new generation. And he's playing second banana to LT and Bam Bam. And number three, by accident, they turned Shawn Michaels babyface. So during the match, Shawn hits the super kick, and at 1.5, Diesel hulks out. The fans boo. I mean, though Shawn and Nash knew it was a bad idea for Shawn to hit the super kick and Diesel hulk out at 1.5. Try telling that to Vince, who Vince made the call for it to happen. Oh, it'll work. Wouldn't you know who won the pony? Diesel hulked up, the crowd booed, Shawn was now a babyface. Diesel retained the championship after the worst jackknife in history. I mean, it wasn't Nash's fault that Shawn landed on his feet and fell backwards. Shawn and Nash were friends, but Shawn wanted that spot more than anything. But Diesel retained the WWF championship. There you go. So you change what Diesel's all about. You put him in a horrible lineup for his first round of house shows as the champion. You do a babyface match with no conclusion at the Rumble. You do a match at WrestleMania against Shawn that played second banana to a football player. So what's next for your new guy, the leader of the new generation? Oh, I know. Have no credible fucking heels for him to work with post-WrestleMania. Because you turned Shawn babyface, Bam Bam lost to LT. I mean, they did do the Diesel Bam Bam match on Raw in late April, which, by the way, that episode of Raw drew the highest rating in Raw history up to that point. To be fair, Diesel Bam Bam wasn't that bad of a match. But Bam Bam lost that match. Post-match, they turned Bam Bam babyface, which resulted for about a 2-month stretch where Diesel and Bam Bam were on-screen buddies. But, you know, you turn Shawn face, you turn Bam Bam babyface, you're running out of heels for Diesel to work with because you're not going to dust Backlund off again. Hell, Backlund lost to Brett, so you're not dusting him off again. Owen Hart and Yokozuna are the tag team champions. Jeff Jarrett is not only the Intercontinental champion, but he's still working with Razor Ramon. So who the fuck is in the heel category for Diesel to work with? By default, Sid is your top heel, and thus your number one contender for the WWF Championship. Now, granted, the pairing of Diesel and Sid made sense. Sid turned on Shawn the night after WrestleMania 11, Diesel made the save, and the only way Diesel would get a match with Sid is if Diesel put the title on the line. And that's what we got for the first In Your House. We got the main event of Diesel versus Sid for the WWF Championship. And by the way, this In Your House, as well as a lot of the In Your Houses, this was the beginning of the B-Show period of time where B-Shows became a thing. Diesel was the king of the B-Shows until Stone Cold. In fact, Diesel had some better B-Show numbers than Austin as the top guy after the Mike Tyson angle. I digress. This one did the best In Your House business until July 1998. But Diesel Sid had their match. The match ended in disqualification. Diesel retained the championship. But this match was famous for Nash suffering a major elbow injury after a chokeslam and powerbomb by Sid, where both moves, he landed on his elbow. Now, Nash continued to wrestle for about another week, but then the injury was serious enough he needed surgery. Now, he wasn't out long, though. By King of the Ring, a month later, Diesel was back in the main event. No joke, this was the main event to King of the Ring. Diesel and Bam Bam Bigelow versus Sid and Tatanka in a tag match. Now, I understand why they did a tag match here. It was help to, you know, help protect Diesel a bit because of the injury. this was not good. This show in general was fucking terrible. I mean, if you've never seen King of the Ring 1995, thank God. It was arguably the worst show in company history. I digress. Diesel and Bam Bam won this match. However, aside from protecting Diesel, this was done to help set up the next month, which for the second In Your House, we got the Diesel-Sid rematch, a lumberjack match for the WWF Championship. At least this match had something else to it other than Shawn Michaels, because their first match, Shawn Michaels was the focal point of the match. It wasn't really Diesel versus Sid, and it really wasn't the title. It was really all about Shawn Michaels. This one had something else to it. You had the injury from their first match in May. Diesel won this to retain the WWF Championship. However, I sort of wish they would have saved this for SummerSlam. Not necessarily do a lumberjack match. You could have just done a regular match for SummerSlam. Because what we ended up getting for SummerSlam, you kind of wish we would have gotten Diesel Sid again. Because what we got for SummerSlam 1995... oh boy. In my opinion, the worst, not just main event, but worst match in SummerSlam history, as well as worst main event program in SummerSlam history. And I'm referring to Diesel versus King Mabel. That's right, King Mabel. One half of Men on a Mission, who was, for all intents and purposes, a joke team. Yeah, they were the tag team champions, but so was Santino and Vladimir Kozlov. But Mabel was one half of Men on a Mission. You know, Mabel couldn't even beat Jeff Jarrett the year earlier at SummerSlam 1994. However, out of nowhere, he won the King of the Ring. And that man, the man who was one half of Men on a Mission, who couldn't beat Jeff Jarrett, and out of nowhere won King of the Ring, he's Diesel's SummerSlam opponent. You know, to refer back to, champions are as only good as their opponents, what the fuck was this? Going back to no credible heels for Diesel to work with, I mean, you know, only if Yokozuna lost weight during his stints off of television in late 94 and early 95, we would have had a credible heel for Diesel to work with. Yoko was a former WWF champion, he was a good worker, he was fucking safe in the ring, and he was a monster, which Vince loved. By this point, Yoko was a tag wrestler, you had nobody else for him to work with, you weren't going to do a third Sid match, so we're stuck with King Mabel. And the match sucked. And Diesel got hurt after Mabel did a sit-out splash on Diesel's spine after Nash told him, "Don't sit on my back." And, okay, splat. He fucking does it anyway. Mabel almost got fired that night, and Nash went, no. If you're gonna fire him, you'll fire me. It was a mistake. Shit happens, but, you know, you don't fire him over it. And, you know, Mabel, he was out of the WWF Championship picture real quick, and then he injured Undertaker, and it was so long until you were Viscera. But, yeah, Diesel won the match at SummerSlam, retained the WWF Championship. Jesus Christ, that was bad. And then we get to September's third In Your House, and they were in a pickle. Because 1995 started the monthly pay-per-views, the B-pay-per-view period of time where it started, you know, these started happening. You needed something monthly. Had this been a year earlier, you would have had a slow burn for something for Survivor Series. But here, you have to have something monthly for the champion to do. So what do you end up doing? I mean, you're not going to do Mabel again. You're not going to do a Sid match again. What the fuck do you do here? So what they did for the third In Your House, it's the third In Your House, I have an idea. Let's have the WWF Champion Diesel team with the Intercontinental Champion Shawn Michaels to take on the Tag Team Champions Owen Hart and Yokozuna in a triple header match. All three championships are on the line. Man who gets the fall first wins the title off of the person he gets the fall on. There must be a winner. A championship will change hands this night. But then you find out that there was no intention of taking the titles off of any of the champions. So why the hell was this match even booked? To waste time, I guess. Because Diesel and Shawn Michaels won the tag team championships off of Yokozuna and Davey Boy Smith, which, yeah, you heard that right, Davey Boy Smith. He was substituting for Owen Hart, and Diesel and Shawn won the match after Diesel pinned Owen Hart, who wasn't even in the match. What kind of crack was Vince smoking here? But this whole thing just, it was a giant waste of time, because the night after, the belts go right back to Yokozuna and Owen Hart. So, again, why book a match where there must be a winner when you have no intention of putting, you know, any of the titles, in changing any of the titles? Why do the match and retcon the whole thing one night later? Makes no fucking sense. But speaking of Davey Boy Smith, now on to Diesel's next program, him and the Bulldog for the fourth In Your House for the WWF Championship. Now, heading into SummerSlam, Davey Boy Smith turned heel on Diesel. Eventually, afterwards, Davey paired up with Jim Cornette, and the whole thing was Davey's sick of being the nice guy. He's sick of being passed over, because he's never once had a WWF championship shot. Because anytime he's ever been brought up, it's like, no, Davey's a nice guy. We'll give the shot to someone else, but Davey, he's a nice guy. He'll understand, you know, we'll do this, we'll do that with him. He's a nice guy. He'll understand. Not anymore. The Davey Boy Smith of old is gone. It's now just the British Bulldog. And for the fourth In Your House, Diesel, Bulldog, WWF Championship. And on paper, this wasn't a bad idea at all. And I say on paper for a reason, because what ended up happening was, and this is all on Vince, I mean, you want to blame Diesel for a bad 1995? Well, the buck stops with the man who fucking owns the company. Because here, you know, what they ended up doing with this match, instead of building Davey up, instead of making the British Bulldog a viable contender, making him a real threat to Diesel for the WWF Championship, they decided to do the worst thing you could possibly do with the world champion. They gave Diesel a losing streak. And that's right, they built the champion down instead of building the challenger up. So, I mean, you've already neutered the character, you've already done so much bad things with Diesel, why not make him, in a kayfabe sense, look weak? And not to mention, this match was a plot device for Brett Bulldog in December. Davey won the match by disqualification. Diesel would retain the title, but this match, it's an infamous match, and a lot of people call it one of the worst world title main events on a pay-per-view during that decade. It was not that good of a match. Again, on paper, you would think Kevin Nash, Davey Boy Smith would be somewhat of a good match, but it was not. And this match, it's pretty infamous for what happened after the match, after the show went off the air, the famous moment of Vince McMahon slamming his headset in disgust. And a lot of people look at this match as the tip of the iceberg that led to Vince pulling the plug on Diesel as champion. And that pulling the plug happened at Survivor Series 1995 the following month. It was Diesel versus Bret Hart for the WWF Championship. They had two prior matches, King of the Ring 1994, Royal Rumble 1995. Both of those matches had really non-finishes, non-conclusive finishes. You had a DQ and a no contest. So here, Survivor Series, this match was no disqualification, no countout, there must be a winner, and it must be a winner by pinfall or submission. Now, of the three matches that these two had, the three major matches, King of the Ring, the Royal Rumble, and the Survivor Series, this match here at the Survivor Series was the best of those three. The story here was great, everything about this match was great, one of the best Survivor Series main events of all time. Bret Hart wins the match, wins the WWF Championship with a small package after Diesel showed a bit of weakness. Diesel put Bret through the table. Diesel was going to hit another jackknife. Bret collapsed. Diesel went up to, you know, get Bret, and then Bret was playing possum, got in the small package, 1-2-3 new champion. You heard a motherfucker from Diesel, and post-match, he's back. Big Daddy Cool returned. Diesel lost it, threw referees, repeated jackknives to Bret, attacked all different referees, being a badass, and the crowd loved it. And the night after on Raw was Kevin Nash's most famous promo as Diesel. Big Daddy Cool is back. He's no longer a corporate puppet. For the first time in a year, he slept like a baby. For the first time in a year, he looked in the mirror and smiled. Big Daddy Cool's back. No longer a corporate puppet. I'm the same Big Daddy Cool from Providence at the Royal Rumble. This was the precursor to what you saw in the Attitude Era, where characters weren't really faces, weren't really heels, it was more in the middle, mostly shades of gray, and that's what Diesel was here. Sure, he attacked Bret, but, you know, he was still a face. People still, you know, I can't say he was a face, because he wasn't a face, he wasn't a heel, he was in the middle. The crowd still cheered him, he still smacked hands, which was a big thing. You know, he was like, you know, it's I'm not saying I won't smack hands, but it better have a glove at the end of it. So, it's kind of ironic that it's like, yeah, I'm no longer a corporate puppet, but buy the Diesel glove and I'll fist bump you. It's like, kind of mixed messages, but at the, I mean, you didn't see that back in the day, but in retrospect, it's like, okay, he's no longer a corporate puppet, but he'll fist bump you, he'll smack your hand if you buy a Diesel glove and wear it. So, you get where I'm going here, but still, that promo the night after Raw was fucking epic, and Big Daddy Cool was back. Diesel's first program out of being the WWF champion was with Owen Hart. That same night Diesel cut his promo is when Owen Hart had a match with Shawn Michaels in the main event. Owen hit Shawn with the enziguri. That started the concussion angle with Shawn, which prompted Diesel to want to destroy Owen for what Owen did to his buddy. In Your House 5, Diesel versus Owen Hart. The match, it really wasn't even a match. It was more of a storyline extender than a match. Because aside from a bit of offense from Owen, this was all Diesel. Granted, Owen won the match by disqualification after Diesel shoved a referee, but after two jackknife powerbombs, both times, this is for you, Shawn, Diesel made his intentions known that he wanted to be WWF champion again. But on that same In Your House show, another wrestler made his intentions known he wanted to be WWF champion again, which led into Diesel's program for WrestleMania 12, him against The Undertaker. The Undertaker, after the casket match with King Mabel, made his intentions known he wanted to be the WWF champion. And The Undertaker was granted the next WWF Championship match against Bret Hart for the 1996 Royal Rumble. Diesel took exception to that because he felt, hey, I deserve that shot. But Undertaker got the match instead. But that same night at the Royal Rumble, Diesel was in the Royal Rumble match. If he won that match, there's no BS, no politics, no nothing about it. Diesel was going to WrestleMania 12. Diesel was going to be the number one contender for the World Wrestling Federation Championship if he won that Royal Rumble match. Diesel ended up the runner-up to Shawn Michaels. Now, frustrated about being passed over for the title match at the Rumble, being frustrated for losing the Rumble match, Diesel cost The Undertaker Undertaker's match against Bret Hart in the main event by getting Bret disqualified. Therefore, Undertaker won the match, but Bret retained the championship. After that, Diesel gave Undertaker the first middle finger ever done on World Wrestling Federation television, and Undertaker vowed it would be a cold day in hell before Diesel ever became WWF champion again. And that cold day in hell never came, because Diesel never became WWF champion again. Diesel got another shot at the WWF championship the following month at the 6th In Your House, Diesel versus Bret Hart in a steel cage match for the title. Undertaker got his revenge at Diesel for what happened at the Royal Rumble. Because during that cage match against Bret, Undertaker pulled Diesel through the ring, Bret escaped to win the match and retain the championship. Now, this match has a pretty famous story to it from behind the scenes, because Bret Hart, according to Kevin Nash, Bret refused to take the jackknife powerbomb because, quote, it would make him look weak. You know, Bret's mind, you know, if I take the jackknife powerbomb, it would make me look weak. It would make me look beatable, so on and so forth, which prompted Undertaker to say, motherfucker, not everything is about you. But, of course, Bret didn't end up taking the jackknife, which was stupid. I mean, hell, the month prior, Bret took the tombstone, and that made Bret look beatable. But here, he wouldn't take the jackknife because it would make him look beatable? Like, what the fuck? So, Diesel and Undertaker, both guy cost the other to be the WWF champion. It was a natural pairing, WrestleMania 12, Diesel versus The Undertaker. Now, I allude back to earlier when I said, you know, people like to say Diesel only had good matches with Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels. I point to the matches with Razor Ramon as being really good matches. And then I point to this one here. WrestleMania 12, Diesel versus The Undertaker. I dare say this one right here is Undertaker's most underrated WrestleMania match. This match here with him and Diesel was really good. And Diesel's entrance is kind of a memorable entrance, because if you watch closely, you will hear Diesel say into the camera, I'm the shit, I'm telling you, which, you know, by this point, Diesel, he was on his way out, so he didn't really give a fuck. Now, Undertaker, like a few years earlier when Undertaker got up after a couple of DDTs, here, Undertaker got up after two jackknife powerbombs. Eventually, Undertaker hit his tombstone for the three, and Undertaker extended what eventually became known as the streak to 5-0. Now, I pointed out just a brief bit ago that Diesel was on his way out, because sometime after the 6th In Your House and before WrestleMania 12, Kevin Nash gave his notice. Nash was about to be a father. He wanted less dates because he wanted to spend time with his kid. He wanted some more guaranteed money, but mostly, he wanted less dates. Scott Hall got a great deal with WCW, told Nash there was a deal in place if he wanted it. Vince refused to match WCW's offer, so Kevin Nash gave his notice. He was on his way to WCW. However, before he went to WCW, he had one more thing left to do. Good friends, better enemies. The no-holds-barred World Wrestling Federation Championship match between him and new WWF champion Shawn Michaels in April 1996. Now, prior to WrestleMania 12, at the Madison Square Garden house show, Diesel completed a full heel turn, because prior to that, he wasn't babyface, he wasn't heel, he was straight in the middle. However, at the MSG house show, prior to WrestleMania 12, Diesel turned heel. He took a chair to everyone during a tag team match with him and Shawn Michaels against Bret Hart and The Undertaker. And when I say he took a chair to everyone, everyone included Shawn Michaels. Now, you want to talk his best program in the WWF, him referring to Diesel? Diesel's final program against Shawn Michaels was an awesome program. Even if it was just a one-match program, it was an awesome program. You had 3 years of build, 3 years of history, their previous breakup, them coming back together, all the stuff leading up to this match. It was great. And, you know, in a lot of ways, it made the most sense for Diesel's last program in the WWF to be with the guy he had been linked with one way or another for the entire time of his time in the company. The match was amazing. The story was amazing. Diesel put Shawn over huge in this match. Shawn defeated Diesel to retain the World Wrestling Federation Championship. And this was his last appearance on television for the WWF until his 2002 return with the NWO. Now, even though Diesel was off of television after the April in Your House, doesn't mean he was done with the WWF just yet. He still had his final run of house shows, if I'm not mistaken, all steel cage matches, all against Shawn Michaels for the WWF Championship, the most famous one of which being May 19th, 1996 in Madison Square Garden. That was Kevin Nash's last match in the WWF for 6 years. But the match really isn't memorable. What's memorable is what happened post-match, because post-match was the famous slash infamous curtain call with Shawn Michaels, Kevin Nash, Scott Hall, and Triple H. They celebrated after the match. The crowd goes crazy. All the old-timers in the back go, "God damn, motherfuckers, kill the fucking business, motherfucker." That's another story. If I ever do a click episode, I'll talk more about the curtain call then. But after that, Kevin Nash, he was on his way back to WCW to start this little thing called the Outsiders and this little bigger thing called the New World Order, and the rest is wrestling history. Now, to describe Kevin Nash's run as Diesel from 1993 to 1996, what's the best way to describe it? You know, I would describe it as successful, yet a case of what could it have been? Because granted, Kevin Nash as Diesel, that was his first huge break in his pro wrestling career, because you look at the prior 3 years of Master Blaster and Oz and Vinnie Vegas and all that shit he got in his first run in WCW, he almost quit the business, but he didn't. Thank God Shawn Michaels watched WCW, he got brought in, he got the Diesel gimmick, and the rest is history. It was because of the Diesel character, his run as Diesel, that he got signed back to WCW to do the Outsiders, to do the NWO, and everything that ended up saving the pro wrestling business. However, as big as Diesel was during that period of time, and he was one of the top five guys during that New Generation period, imagine what he could have been had they not botched his WWF Championship run. I mean, granted, shit happens for a reason, but imagine if they booked Diesel as a badass during that run as the WWF Championship. You know, who knows what could have happened if they booked him properly as champion, if they didn't neuter him, if they didn't give him bad opponents, if they didn't lower his stock, if they didn't do all the mistakes they did during that period of time. Imagine how different things would have been. Maybe things wouldn't have been different at all. But you never know. In an alternate universe, Diesel is WWF champion. He would have been champion for multiple years, and the WWF would have been fucking amazing during that period of time. But in this universe, that's the end of Diesel 1993 to 1996. The time to get to your Diesel questions. If you have any questions for next week's topic, which is the Hollywood Blondes, send them in the comments section below. Craig starts off by asking, if the fan base in 1995 was like it is today, would fans shit all over Diesel like they do with Roman Reigns and John Cena before that, booing him and complaining that Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels aren't on top? Well, is the sky blue? Is the grass green? Is Scarlet Bordeaux Roll Tide? Well, the answers to all of that are yes, yes, And fuck yes. Of course. If the fan base of 1995 was like it is here in 2018, oh hell, they would have destroyed Diesel, and they would have destroyed a lot of other things in wrestling history. I mean, they would have... Could you imagine the fan base of today back in 1995? Oh, dear God. Zach asks, does the blame for the WWF's poor business go solely on Diesel, or should it be blamed on the booking of the entire roster? Well, you know, it's like a sports team. You win as a team, you lose as a team. Sure, the champion is essentially like the quarterback, but you can't put what happened during the WWF in the year 1995 solely on Diesel. That entire roster was... They booked the entire roster horribly. It was... Oh God. I mean, was it Diesel's fault that they booked him against horrible house show opponents at first, that they booked him in a babyface match that split the crowd, that they had no heels for him to work with after Mania, they lowered his stock instead of increasing Challenger's stock? Was it Diesel's fault? Fuck no, it wasn't. So it's not solely on Diesel, it's on the entire roster. Again, you win as a team, you lose as a team. Prince asks, what are some missed opportunities for Diesel feuds and matches? I briefly mentioned Yokozuna, but that was in that hypothetically if Yokozuna was 100 pounds lighter. Now, I look at Owen Hart. Because they started the angle after WrestleMania 10 with Owen Hart after he beat Bret, that he's going to do everything Bret did, but do it better. And if it's something Bret couldn't do, he would do because, hey, I beat Bret, therefore I'm better than Bret. You could have ran that here. Bret couldn't beat Diesel. Well, guess what? I'm better than Bret. I'm going to beat Diesel. I'm going to do what my rotten brother couldn't do, and that's beat Diesel for the WWF Championship. You know, they could have ran that, but we got King Mabel instead. William asks, was it always the plan to make Diesel way before Royal Rumble 1994? You know, it's funny, Kevin Nash was brought in strictly as a bodyguard at first, so he was thought of as a manager. Nobody saw him as a threat because, hey, he's a manager. But then you get to Royal Rumble 1994 and that awesome performance, and the crowd goes fucking crazy. It's one of those things, you never know how a crowd's going to react. Vince hears that and it's like, well, he's more than a bodyguard? He could be my champion. And look what happened. Valentino asks, why did the WWF allow Diesel to have a long title reign as WWF champion despite not being a draw? Oh boy. You know, I didn't mention it because I didn't really want to bring it up, but I'm going to. The whole notion of Kevin Nash is the lowest drawing champion in WWE history is 100% grade A bullshit. Oh God, that whole, who created that notion that, oh, Nash is the lowest drawing champion ever? Somebody who had more time than stuff to do. Guess what? Get a hobby. YouTube is mine. But Diesel wasn't, you know, he wasn't a Hogan draw, but he wasn't an Eddie Guerrero draw. You know, for those who don't know, domestically here in the States, Eddie Guerrero was the lowest drawing champion in history. You know, lower than Diesel, lower than Jinder Mahal, lower than anybody else in company history. Diesel, in fact, was, you know, in the middle. He wasn't a Hogan draw, an Austin draw, or anybody like that, but he wasn't a low draw. He was just in the middle. Why was he champion for a year? I mean, hell, Vince loved him. I mean, you see what happened at the Royal Rumble. He proved himself everywhere possible, so Vince put the title on him. And then Vince fucked him up. but, you know, the whole him not being a draw, he was a better draw than a lot of people. It wasn't his WrestleMania's champion that was the lowest drawing WrestleMania in history. That was Sid's WrestleMania's champion. So, there you go there. Dragon asks, do you think they should have turned Nash heel during his long title run? If so, when and how? You know, I don't think they should have turned him heel, per se. What they should have done, and I've mentioned it many times before, but they should have never turned him into this pandering doofus. They should have never neutered him. The badass character he was throughout his entire 1994 run is what he should have been as the champion. His time after he lost the title when Big Daddy Cool was back, that's what he should have been as the champion. Don't know how successful that would have been, but it would have been a hell of a lot better than what we ended up getting. So, you know, they shouldn't have turned him heel, but they should have never neutered him in the first place. So, and finally, Mr. Red asks, do you think Diesel's, and by extension, Kevin Nash's contributions to professional wrestling are unfairly shat upon by fans today, and do you think Nash is underrated? Well, for the first part, Nash's contributions to professional wrestling are huge. Because again, him, Scott Hall, as the outsiders. You know, they brought Hogan in as the third man. That gave Hogan a second life in pro wrestling, because prior to that, Hogan was on the downslide. It was because of the outsiders. It was because of the New World Order. Hogan got a second life in pro wrestling. And, you know, if it wasn't for the NWO, WWF wouldn't have upped their game, which meant WWF wouldn't have done all they did. You would have never had that boom period during the Attitude Era if it wasn't for the NWO in May 1996 with the introduction of the Outsiders. So Diesel's contributions are huge. Oh, and by the way, WWE contracts today, Outsiders say you're welcome. Now, in terms of Nash being underrated, fuck yeah, he's underrated, because people want to compare Nash to smaller wrestlers, which, that's apples and oranges. You compare Kevin Nash to other giants, other guys 6'10 and taller, outside of Undertaker, Andre, maybe Big Show, name me a giant better in the history of the business. I mean, Kevin Nash, he could talk, he had charisma, he could go in the ring when necessary. So, you know, he wasn't fucking Gigante or Kali or Silva or, you know, Kurgan or any of those guys. He had something to him. He wasn't just another generic giant. Again, outside of Taker, Andre, maybe Big Show, name me a giant 6'10 or taller that was better than Kevin Nash. So absolutely, his contributions are shat upon unfairly, and Kevin Nash is underrated as a performer. Thanks to everyone who sent in questions. Again, next week, the Hollywood Blondes. Until next time, peace.